How about now?
Yeah.
All right. Well, guys, let's open up our Bibles to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, we're going to talk about therefore there is no condemnation. You guys like that, huh?
Yes.
No condemnation.
Yeah.
You know, I want to say this. You know, God's word is good. And it's good all the time. And, you know, I'm very, very thankful for what the Lord is doing in our church. I like it. We're going into a new building. Like Pastor Zach said, there's great air. It's a really nice environment. There's great, you know, room for the children. I prayed a while back with the pastors, and I really felt like the Lord was kind of taking us through a wilderness, and Pastor Mark begins to share in Samuel, and you know, you look at how God brings all of us together, and how have we done in the last year? How have we responded to the Lord in taking us through maybe a time of wilderness? I think sometimes when I sit way over on that side, and you're really, bless your hearts over there, for sitting way over there where there's no air conditioning, I think sometimes how it gets hot, it gets miserable.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's so easy to start complaining, you know. And then I thought, and I'm just going to say this and we'll get into the word, but, you know, I thought about what God's been doing in my life in the last few months. And, you know, for those of you that know that Patty has never known, seen, heard of having a father in 49 years. And, you know, she's been on the search, she's been asking the Lord, you know, God, if this is what you want, then reveal it. If it's not what you want, then just shut every door. There's 300,000 Jim Needhams. There's, you know, how am I going to find that, you know, one guy of that many? You know, we would go to big old family reunion, or we would go to the class reunion, and I kind of have a weird way of finding out if he may be there. My thing was, hey, did anybody sleep with Karen? Everybody's looking at me like, dude, what are you doing? You know, I'm with my wife, I'm looking for her daddy. So the food was great. But we didn't find one. We said, well, that didn't work. So we went to a family reunion. We tried to talk a little bit to some of the family. The family's really close down. The mom went to her grave not telling her who her father was. So, you know, I have a father. Some of you have a father. But my heart went out for my wife not having a father. Yes, she's got a heavenly father, but we know the difference between, you know, a father right here that, you know, you guys know the difference. Okay. So we just asked God, and it was definitely a step of faith for us, because all of a sudden through the DNA and through the ancestry.com, God, he got some names, got some people, and it was so awesome because it connected her to her cousin. And as it connected her to her cousin, she began to share a little bit and call and this, that, and the other, and all of a sudden God, he left a message on the phone, and the wife calls and says, yes, my husband's name is Jim. Yes, he was in the Army, military, Navy. Yes, he was this. Yes, he was that. Okay, well, you know, all of a sudden, she just said on the phone, you know what, I don't want you calling me stepmother, I am your mother. And, you know, there was no resistance whatsoever. I think we had more resistance. And as we began to find out there in New York, we booked some flights, we went out there, and guys, I got to tell you something, I had the best time in my life. I just watched my wife just, you know, take her father and wheel him around in the parking lot in a wheelchair, pray with him, love on him. I mean, I think I probably cried more than she did. You know what I mean? I felt retarded. You know, I went to a family uncle's house, and I'm looking at the uncle, and the dude is the most happiest guy in the whole world, and he's laughing real hard, and then all of a sudden, you know, we started talking about his condition, and then he started to cry. And then I'm trying to pray for him, and I just started bawling. I couldn't even pray. Because, you know, when you love the Lord, you have a way of connecting with Christians. You have a way of connecting with people that hurt. You see, it's just natural. Jesus said, you know, when I was a stranger, you took me in. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was sick, you know, you came to me. When I was in prison, you visited me. I mean, it's like there's a connection. And if you don't have that connection, there's something wrong with your connection. You see? And I love the fact that God ministers to us, and I love the fact that as we were there, it was like all of a sudden we have this million people family. You know, we got people coming out of the woodwork, and I mean, we were so busy doing the Lord's work there that it was such a neat experience. You know? And I don't know about you guys, but I gotta say this to everyone. You know, we went to the Napa Falls, you know what I mean? And we're standing and we're looking over the edge. Man, I don't know if anybody ever gets this feeling, but I wonder what it would be like to go up a little ways and jump off and ride it down. You know what I mean? And I thought, wow, man, that was stupid. You know? Because we know what it would be like, amen? I said, what if I throw my floating phone and just put it on record and watch it come on the internet? You know? And then I thought, no, I'm going to get rid of my phone. I still need it. You know? And you know, it was a weird experience for me at that place, seeing such powerful water and seeing God's nature, seeing what God does. And guys, I got to tell you something. When I came back, as I hear about this disaster in Houston, in Texas, my heart goes out, guys. And I ask, please, please, please be praying. Please be praying. And I'm not talking about for just our journey to go out there. I'm talking about for these people that have lost everything. How many of you know what it feels like when you go out to your car and your battery's dead? You know what I mean? Your car doesn't start. How many of you know when, you know, you go out and your car is gone? How many of you know that when, you know, you're driving down the freeway and your windshield gets hit by a rock and it cracks and you think your world just ended? Now think about somebody that came out and their car is gone. Their life and everything that they've ever had is gone. All their memories are gone as far as pictures, and maybe even a family member is drowning. And all of a sudden, there's a burden in my heart, guys, that goes out. And I want to ask, please, please be praying for these people in Texas. And not only that, but as we prepare, I just want to help you guys ahead of time so you don't go into shock if you feel God's calling you. If you feel the Lord is prompting you, the church, the house of the ministry, we're going to come together. We're going to put together a team. I first said 8, then I said 10, and I said, God, how many of you want to send? We have already made several connections with Texas. Okay? We are not first responders, so we will not respond first. But we will go in a couple weeks from now. Okay? But I'm going to tell you something. If you feel a stirring in your heart, you better fast. And you better start doing some jumping jacks and push-ups. Because I'm going to tell you something, when you get there, it will wear you out. And the last thing you want to do is carry weight. Amen? We want to make sure when we go that we're ready to serve and ready and equipped and our hearts are right. We have prayed our way through it and said, Lord, here I am, take me, use me. I'm going to tell you something, you will have the time of your life. You will come back here to California and you will realize how good you really have it. Amen? See, sometimes we don't know until we've been in a disaster what it's like. So, guys, open your Bibles up with me to Romans chapter 8. And, you know, I love Romans. I love how Paul had experienced his journey and how Paul went through the things he went through. But that, you know, Paul comes to a place where he realizes that there's a conversion in Paul's life. And Paul's conversion wasn't in the flesh. Paul's conversion was in the spirit. If you notice, when you look at the scripture and it talks about, you know, the things that I ought not to do, I find myself doing, and the things I ought to do, I'm struggling with in my body and my mind and my heart are warring. And, you know, there are these things that are going on, just like the scripture says, the flesh and the spirit are contrary to one another, that we don't do the things that we wish. And how many of us on a daily basis are finding ourselves doing the things that we should not do? And we think, oh no, it's over, I'm in trouble, I'm condemned. Well, guys, can I tell you something? The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. And guys, I can only tell you, you know, read your Bible, pray every day, and you will grow, grow, grow. Amen? Some of you remember singing the song in church. But I got to tell you something today. I've seen so many people that they fall away and they start living in this condemnation, this guilt. They start thinking, well, I'm not good enough. Have you ever felt that way in your life? I'm just not good enough to be a Christian. Can I tell you, you're absolutely right. That's why Jesus died. That's why Jesus died. You know, I think to myself, I am so glad every time I look at myself in the mirror that Jesus died for me. Every time I make a mistake, I think about it. Jesus died for me. Every time I have one of them thoughts, Jesus died for me. So God, help me to rely and trust in your Son, Jesus Christ. So it's no longer I that live, but then who? Christ that lives in me. That's who I want alive in me. And it is so hard, guys. I know that. So let's pray. Let's jump into the Word. Father, we just thank you so much, Lord. We ask that your Spirit would just move in our hearts tonight. And Lord, we do lift up Texas, as I was just pulling my phone out, Lord, as Tom Holland has boarded his house up. He's had to leave everything. And Lord, it's no power, no electricity. God, it's dark. And Lord, there's so much going on there. We lift them up. And as we're standing here, sitting here tonight, having church service, help us to keep them in our hearts and in our prayers. Father, we ask now that your Holy Spirit would just minister to us in Jesus' name. Amen. So, Romans 8, verse 1. It says, there is therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life is Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. Verse 4, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their mind on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God. For it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then, those who are in the Spirit or in the flesh cannot please God. Verse 9, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. Verse 10, and if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. I believe in meeting Christ. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit whom dwells in you. You know, there's a lot said there. Excuse me. And I know this is Paul, as being a Pharisee, understood this best. Paul living under the Mosaic law. Paul being a Pharisee, knowing how to be very un-Pharisee. Knowing how to understand the writings of the scribes and the law and the letter of the law and to follow the law. You know, if we today tried to live in the flesh and live by the law, we would fail, wouldn't we? We would fail miserably. But God in his word declares what? Is that it was condemned in the sense that we couldn't do it, but he could. I would be condemned if I was to try to live according to the law. So God says in his word, and as I go back through Romans, he says, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Listen to this. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made what? Made me free from the law of sin and death. Here it is. It says, for what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by what? Sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, on account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. So, here's how we look at it, guys. I know today for me that if I tried to say I obey I've already broken one. I lied. Amen? I know that if I go and I go throughout my day and I say I have not sinned, I'm a liar. I understand that. So what I do is I say what the flesh cannot do, God can do in the spirit. So what does it take? It takes being born again. And guys, people struggle today. They struggle. Why can't I overcome? Why can't I overcome this? Why can't I overcome that? Well, guys, because you're still trying to do it in your flesh. See, I remember there was a time in my life where I, as a believer, was backsliding. I was backsliding. I was struggling. My mind was fighting with the Lord and was saying, God, I can't do this. Why am I trying to be something I'm not? Have you ever felt like that? Have you ever told yourself, why am I trying to be something I'm not? And you go, well, what do you mean by that? Well, have you ever heard the devil tell you, why are you trying to be something you're not? You're not a Christian. You're an idiot. What? And you start going, really? And you start listening more and more to the enemy. You ever notice that? And pretty soon he says, oh, you're never going to get that. You're never going to make that. You're never going to come. You will never. Hey, you know what? You're a loser. Once a loser, always a loser. I mean, just like, I want to say this very kindly, very loving, just like some programs today. Once an alcoholic, always an alcoholic. That's not what 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, is it? 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things pass away, behold, all things become new. So if I haven't drank in 26 years, why would I say I'm an alcoholic? Isn't the word alcoholic one who habitually drinks? Isn't the one that says he's a drug addict one that habitually does drugs or always doing drugs? Absolutely. Just want to fix this. I heard it off of you. It's probably me. I'm sweating. But, guys, when we look at God's Word, and I realize that if I'm in Christ, I'm a new creation. I'm not going to introduce myself as Pastor Tom, a drug addict. I'm going to introduce myself as Pastor Tom, a new creation in Christ. Why? Because if I live in the flesh, I will certainly die in the flesh. I will not live in the spirit because I'll have died in the flesh, in the sense of separate from the Spirit of God. I want to live in Christ. I want to be a new creation. How many of you guys really want God to bring up your past? Hey, check this out. You see that screen right there?
Yeah.
Is there anybody in here tonight that would even dare to let us have God give us your CD of your life since you've been a Christian, and say, let's slip it in the machine and let's play it? Anybody in here feel like they can do that even today as a believer? You're jacked up, huh? Aren't you glad the Lord loves you? Because see, I would see your video and I would go, oh my gosh, are you kidding? Right? So aren't you glad that the Lord loves you? Aren't you glad that you're... But now let's take this a step further. Doesn't that make you want to change? Doesn't that make you want to change? When God is not going to put your life up there, especially not your past before Christ. But since you've been a Christian, you still be going, wait a minute, I don't know if we should show this. There's a few things I got mixed up at one point about grace. Okay? Guys, I've got to tell you something. God's grace should change you. Amen? God's grace should make you say, I don't want to go to that part of it. I don't want to drink. Oh, my liberty, say I can drink. I don't want to drink. Because how many of you know what you do when you drink? You say, oh, I'm just real mellow. Oh, that ain't what I saw. You know, that is not the way you love. Don't tell me you just drink and you're so mellow and calm and you just go to sleep after watching a little TV. So as Paul says, guys, if you're living according to the flesh, you're going to die. You're going to be separated from God. But if you live according to the Spirit, you're going to have life. And I like what he says right here, because this to me, as he says in verse 4, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who did not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set what? They set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those that live according to the Spirit, they set their minds on the things of the Spirit. In that sense, guys, let me tell you something. How many of you think on a daily basis how you can serve the Lord? On a daily basis, are you going, man, I just want to know, I want to serve the Lord. There's God, please, set me up. Guys, can I tell you something? That should be every day, shouldn't it? God, make an occasion. God, put somebody in front of me. God, allow me to pray with somebody. Lord, let me love my wife like your word declares in Ephesians, as you love the church, Christ. And God, allow me to say a word fitly spoken like the proverb says, or like apples of gold in a setting of silver. God, help me to have words that would bring life to people. But also help me, God, to say what might need to be said. Because so many times we're so afraid to say things, aren't we? Good or bad. Because it can get so misconstrued. But you know what? If you live according to the Spirit, you will set your mind on the things of the Spirit. Amen? And tonight, guys, I got to tell you something. Some of you are really worn. Some of you are fighting right now. Some of you are really struggling. Man, should I really do this or not? Should I really continue? Hey, man, maybe when we change churches, I can change my lifestyle and go away from the church. Because they'll be in a different location and maybe they won't recognize that I don't come home. It ain't about us recognizing if you're not in fellowship. It's about the Lord. Guys, I know that Paul was dealing with religious people. There's a side that can be real religious too, right? They call those sin sniffers. They're sniffing out everybody else's sin but their own. Okay, but they look real holy. I mean, amen, they got, oh yeah, they stand on the corners, you know, 9 o'clock in the morning and pray with their hand up at 12 o'clock and they pray, and then they go at 3 o'clock and then they pray, and then they go and sin. Guys, I don't want to teach us that we should be fake as Christians. We should be transparent, amen. We should be transparent. How many of you in here today have had a bad day? Just haven't had a real good day, okay? All right, can I tell you something? When you go home tonight and you pray that God gives you a better day tomorrow, and that you can put your sights and your focus on the Lord, and God, whatever I went through today, Lord, let me use it tomorrow to glorify you. Could you do that? You know, could you make good out of something that the enemy would want to make bad? Yes, you can. I know this is God's grace has shown me that I don't have to live a condemned life anymore. See, condemnation is I'm condemned, I'm guilty, there's no hope. Doesn't the scripture say, therefore, there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ? And what? Pay attention. Those that are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Guys, every day we should be praying, opening up our Bible, reading, asking God to direct us, shouldn't we? Every single day, and then moving on down, listen to what he says here. In verse 6, he says, for to be carnally minded is what? Is death. It's separation. And guys, if you don't understand what it means to have a carnal mind, it's all about the flesh and how I can feel good, whether God likes it or not. Guys, there's things in our lives. We as the body of Christ have things in our life that God wants to kind of purge out of you. How many of you guys, you know, like me right now, I don't know if you can see, I'm not on speed, okay? If you think I'm getting sucked up because I'm using milk, that's not the thing. I'm starting to take the garbage out of my life. The real fatty food and the, man, I went to the doctor and the lady told me, man, I'm going to die. I says, I thought I looked really good. She goes, I don't care how good you look, your insides are jacked up. You're a diabetic, you're type 2. I said, what do you mean I'm type 2? And I can eat all the sugar I want. You know what I mean? And she goes, no. She goes, you got a 9 on the scale, you had a 12, you're down to a 9, but you I said, what the heck is going on? She says, what do you eat and drink every day? I said, oh man, I love coffee, I love energy drinks, I love, man, I love so high, man, I like Reese's peanut butter cups, I like. Okay? And guys, can I tell you something? I'm giving you a metaphor right now. Okay? I'm giving you a metaphor, I'm giving you a title. So they said, but you don't see your liver going bad. You don't see your kidneys going bad. You don't see some of the internal things that are going on inside of your body. She goes, let me ask you something. Do you get blurred vision? I said, yeah. She goes, well, do you ever feel like your feet hurt? Oh, heck yeah. She goes, then it's already doing damage inside. She gives me a chest and doing my hands. I feel like I was getting a drunk chest. You know what I mean? I even messed that chest up. You know, and she goes, no, I want you to touch here and then touch my hand. I'm like, She goes, no, go like this, go like this. I was all mixed up. And I'm like, am I messed up? Well, she says you better change your habits. And I got concerned. And I said, well, and she goes, oh, I want to remind you too, your cholesterol is really high. She goes, your blood pressure. I thought she was going to say nothing. She goes, your blood pressure, it's at about 90 over 160, 170. She goes, you know you're going to have a stroke. And I'm like, really? I go, man, I felt really good. So, man, I've had to discipline myself. Okay? I've had to discipline myself. I've had to lose some weight. I don't feel as if I can feel my belt next to my tummy. I like that, man. Before I use that belt. You know what I mean? You get to my belt. You know? When I lean over, man, I used to go, you know? It's like, and I'm like, all of a sudden I get up and I go, whoa, that was free. You know, I got the biggest head rush. And guys, you know, this is funny, kind of. You're laughing a little bit. But the truth of the matter is it's damaging. And it's just like sin. It seems funny. It seems funny. But it's doing damage inside. And guys, I got to tell you something. You think because I don't know it, Pastor Mark don't know it, your wife don't know it, your job don't know it, your whoever don't know it, God knows it. Amen? Amen. And guys, God determines our lives. See, you're not saved by the health law. Like crawfish, eating hook this, hook that, this, that. But can I tell you something? Those Old Testament health laws sure helped you live better. Just like you're not saved by the law, you're saved by grace. So do we take advantage of grace in the wrong way? No. That's the point about not walking in the flesh, but walking in the spirit. And I remember my wife's grandmother telling you, I never felt like strangling somebody as much as I wanted to strangle her. Every time, I mean, I'm not going to call it Pentecostal, I'm going to call it charismatic. Because it's really gifts of above. Pentecost is a day. Okay, that's what we need to study. But this woman was very, very, very charismatic, loved the Lord, was blessed with gifts. She goes, you know, your problem, Tom, is you're walking in the flesh. A woman, she goes, you need to learn how to walk in the spirit. And I'm like, okay. You know, what am I supposed to be, a ghost? Because I was so angry about my flesh. I was so angry that I couldn't submit to the Lord. Have you ever been like that? Everything you do seems to be in the flesh. Nobody else like that? You think guys like that? I'm going to say, you're in the flesh right now because you're lying. We are like that. We're like that. But you know what the good thing is we serve a loving God. We serve a good God. We serve a God that wants to help you walk in the Spirit. So her grandmother goes, well, Tom, if you just live to please the Lord, you'll walk in the Spirit. I'm like, are you kidding?
She goes, yeah, why don't you pray and ask God to direct your day? Why don't you get into God's word and let God speak to you? And I'm thinking, you know, those are things I don't believe. I just assume that I can live on what I know. You ever felt like that? I can just live on what I know now. I'm a Christian. I know a little bit of the Bible. I'll just live on what I know. I don't need to go to church anymore. I don't need to, I mean, guys, you've seen it, right? People will come to church when they're desperate. People will cry. I mean, you know, all kinds of tears. Everything will start going better, then they won't show up no more. They call that a superficial commitment. And then they wonder why they never have a breakthrough. Because God is like, switch. Turn them on. But you want to tell you something? My King, my God, is a light switch. Amen? He's either on, I'll let you stay. He's on. Guys, I share tonight that God doesn't want us to feel condemned. He doesn't want us to live where the enemy makes you feel like it's hopeless. Do you ever notice when you sin, you doubt whether you're saved? I'm talking about habitually practicing. You go, man, am I really a Christian? And then he goes, no, you're a heathen. You might as well keep going. No, repent. Repent. Get before the Lord and just ask God, God, restore my heart. God, make it ever new. And God will restore your heart. Because guys, as we move on down, I want to close, because I know it's very hot. I want to close within the next couple minutes. Okay? Don't say, yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay, stop that. You're sinning. Okay? And he says, as he moves on down, he says in verse 8, so those who are in the flesh, what? Cannot please God. There it is. You cannot please God, but you are not in the flesh. Didn't he just say it? But you are not in the flesh. He says, but in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you, now if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. If you don't feel anything, you feel dead tonight. You don't feel nothing. You don't feel the Spirit convicting you. You don't feel anything inside of you. You don't feel like, man, when I punch somebody in the eye, when I run somebody over, I don't feel anything. It is kind of like, well, yeah, man, that feels good. Tonight, you need to stay. You really do. You need, I'm going to tell you something. You cannot live like that. You want to just surrender and say, you know what, God, I'm done with this, man. This is making me miserable. I do not want to live like this. Hey, can I tell you something? You can come to church and not be saved. Amen? Do you really think that everybody that goes to church is born again? Guys, that's why the Lord loves you so much. He wants you to evaluate your heart so he can show you his love. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you more than you will ever know unless you open the door to your heart. Amen? He wants to love on you. It's so weird when God showed me how much he loves me. It was kind of weird. I felt kind of embarrassed because I had been fighting God. I felt embarrassed because I was like resisting such a wonderful relationship that now I have today. And I'm like, man, I just want you to have it. Have you ever wanted somebody to have it so bad you wanted to beat them with it? But it doesn't work that way. You can't beat somebody with salvation. You either want it or you don't. And I know that tonight, as he says this, this may help you a little bit. He says, you are not his in essence. But he says in verse 10, and if Christ is in you, listen to this, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit of, listen to this, I love this. He says, but the Spirit is life because of God, Christ, righteousness. It's Christ, righteousness that has made you alive tonight. Not your good works. Sure, it does good to be obedient and not habitually practice sin. But guys, can I tell you something? It's Christ that's in you that teaches you how to not practice sin. Amen? If you don't have Christ in you, these are elementary doctrine things of Jesus Christ. If you don't have Jesus Christ in you, you will never know how or have the strength to not practice sin. That's why you keep practicing. Because you're resisting it. Resisting Christ. But, this is verse 11. But if the Spirit of Him who raised, listen to this, Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through, listen to this, through His Spirit whom dwells in you. Guys, I want to keep going, but it's hot. But I got to tell you something tonight. As he goes on, therefore, brethren, we are what? We are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if we live according to the flesh, we will die, or you will die. But if by the Spirit you will put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are what? The sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again, okay, to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with Him, that we may also be glorified to Him. Guys, I just want to tell you something. We're just going to bow our heads right now. We're going to close up. I made it before at 8:30. Blessed be His name. But guys, can I tell you something tonight, please? Please, I'm reading in Rebuild Hammett. I'm reading in Sanderson, a Crime Watch, this, that, the other. Guys, people are dying all over, so much more than ever before. Ran over, head-on collision, drunk driving, OD. Do you know today we had a guy climbing up on the telephone pole was going to jump because they didn't give him his benefits for being crazy? You think I'm kidding? Look on Hammett News. He's up on the power pole. They shut down the whole gym, the whole neighborhood, everything. This morning, he was up there all night. Up on the pole. And then guess what? They talked him down, man, and they shot him with a stinking shotgun with beanbags in it. Because he was going to run and take off. Can I tell you something? That's not our God. I know they wanted to give help. I know they didn't want him to run. But I'll tell you what, 20 cops and one guy didn't have a shoot. I'm sorry. Guys, the Lord wants to rescue you. Amen. And if you haven't been rescued, tonight may be your night. So I just want you to bow your heads with me. We're going to pray. We're going to close out. And I want to encourage you, as you're sitting here tonight, guys, as I begin to pray, I'm just going to ask you, if you have any question of your salvation, listen to me closely. Do not hesitate if you want to be saved. You stand up. You stand up. We're going to pray for you. We're going to lead you in a prayer. Because you cannot go through this life always questioning whether you're saved or not. God is not a light switch. Let's pray. Father, we just come before you. And Lord, as we close out tonight, God, we know this, that we are not debtors to the law of flesh. God, we want to be your children, your servants. We want to live under your grace, your mercy. And Lord, we know that in every single letter that ever says grace and peace, there's no way we will ever have peace without the grace of God. So Lord, I pray that if there's anyone in here tonight that has just been wrestling, questioning, Lord, there's nothing wrong with standing up tonight and being for sure. So if you're in here tonight and you have been questioning where you're at, you have been struggling whether I've really given my life to Christ, I am challenging you tonight to stand up to your feet and I'm going to pray for you. Okay? Because it's time for you to know where you stand. It's time for you to know that when I give my heart to Jesus Christ, I am born again, I'm saved. But if nothing is changing, if I'm struggling over and over and over and over and I'm giving in, it's time for me to have the power of the Holy Spirit to change my life from this day forward. If you are that person, you just stand right there. You don't have to come on up. Just I want you to stand up right where you're at. Amen? You just stand up because God sees you tonight. But you know what? The body of Christ needs to lift their heads up and look around the room and pray for these people. Just start praying for them right now. And then you come on out here. Come on out here, man. Don't hide in that room back there. Okay? But guys, we are going to pray for these people right now. We're going to pray. And we're going to pray that God does a mighty work in their lives. Because you know what, guys? We will not make it without the Spirit. I'm going to tell you that right now. You will not please God in the flesh. You're either going to be a debtor to God or you're going to be a debtor to your flesh. Just see. Amen? So can I have Anthony, will you do me a big favor? Go inside that room in there and you and your wife there, lay hands on these people. Okay? A few of you guys come on over here. You just put some hands on these guys. Those of you that feel like you're in the Spirit, come on over here, put your hands on these guys. Okay? We're going to pray right now. We're going to close out. It's still 8:30. But you know what? Tonight, you need to quit struggling with whether you're saved or not, because tonight you're going to give your heart to Christ for real. Amen? And then you're going to ask the Holy Spirit, yeah, go ahead. Someone, just go put some hands on our brother over here standing up, right behind you there. Okay? Guys, we're going to stand in agreement tonight. These two guys stood up, so let's get some guys that are in there. Are you coming up for prayer? Okay, do me a favor. Pastor Tony, where are you? Robert. Guys, I really want a revival in the church. I really do. I really want to see people get saved and on fire and quit falling back into the world because they're lacking the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen? And I can say this really simply, it sucks to struggle and struggle and struggle and struggle and not be able to overcome. Amen? So bow your heads. I'm going to pray for you, and I'm going to ask you to repeat these words after me. And as we lay hands on you, I'm going to tell you something. If there's anything in your life, you need to say, Lord, I give it up tonight. Don't leave this room and get back on your cell phone and start looking at pornography. Don't go back to the liquor store. Don't be sleeping with somebody else's wife or husband. Knock it off. Submit to the Lord and live for Christ. Amen? So, Father, right now, I just come to you and I lift up your church. God, they're your people. You've created. You've created them for your purpose, for your glory. And Lord, tonight there's been a few people that have stood up that, Lord, have been struggling, have been battling with sin, have been battling in the flesh. And Lord, they don't want to hear condemnation. They want to hear, therefore, there is no condemnation because they are walking in Christ. So, Father, tonight, as they commit their hearts to you, God, I pray you will wash them clean. As your word declares in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to not only forgive us, but to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, because tonight they will be your children. And Lord, I pray that as they confess, Lord, that God, you will just wipe it out, and that, Lord, you will fill them from their head to their toes with your Holy Spirit, that they would be empowered, and Lord, the next thing we would see in them is they'd be singing a new song for you. So right now, I just ask those of you that are standing to your feet, that have said, I want to surrender, repeat these words. Dear God, I have sinned. I have missed the mark. I have rebelled. I ask tonight that God, you would forgive me, that you would cleanse me, as I believe that Jesus Christ died for me. I believe that tonight. I receive that tonight. And God, I need you to set me free. I pray you fill me right now with your Holy Spirit. God, empower me as your word declares. God, I'm your child. And I want to walk as you. Thank you tonight for the blood of Jesus. And Lord, if there's anything that is clung on to my life, I renounce it tonight. I surrender it to you, and I give it to you freely, and I don't ever want it back. God, I thank you tonight for saving her. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you for letting me share with you, but guys, this is the next step. If you don't have a Bible, you need to come and say something. If you do have a Bible, you need to start reading it every day. You need to pray every day. You need to ask God to teach you every day. And let me just tell you this. And the last thing is, you walk out those doors, thank the Lord for saving your soul. Amen? God bless you guys. Thank you so much for letting me share with you, and have a good night.